am Sangeeta. I am 16 years old. 10 years I am here.
Mother of the girl, Sangeeta, came. She knew that she is going to leave the world very soon. With that motive, she came and asked us, can you please help Sangeeta?
And we said, okay, if God wants us to take care of the children, you know, we do the right thing.
We started to receive many HIV children from different places. We started the program. It was the beginning.
So the Homes of Hope, we have around 11 locations, taking care of the children 24/7 for 600 children. And probably half of them are infected with HIV, and the other half don't have the infection, but their parents have passed away because of the disease. They have a very good facility, and they have a lot of joy and peace, and they can play with other children, and they have connection with the caretakers, and they are able to go to school. And we use the word transformation a lot, and I think these are real transformations and real changes, and it's a privilege that God is using us, and then God is using many other people around the world to bring transformation and change.
When I was 4, I came to Calvary Chapel.
My father worked in Mumbai. He started having relations with other women. That's how he got HIV AIDS. My mom also got infected through HIV and AIDS. So we both died.
I came here because my parents passed away. My father consumed more drugs and my mother committed suicide. I have been here for more than 12 years.
Because I was a small boy, I don't know what to do. Father Guna said, don't worry about anything. I will take care of you.
I like him, so I call him father. He also shows love on me.
When I came to Calvary Chapel, I got many parents. I mean, who cared for me.
I think God done the good plan in my life.
I want to become a doctor because I want to serve the people who are in illness.
As a businessman, I like to do social work because when we give our love to others, that is real joy.
Most important things in my life is God love us. We have to love others.
Sumanth, in November, he came. His weight was 12 kilos, like 4 year children in India, but his age was 14. Since he was HIV, he was pushed out from the community. He was on the roadside, so abandoned.
They don't even know that they have a problem like that, but the society has already started looking down upon them. With children like Sumanth, it can be, anything can happen at any time. And that's why nobody wants to take care of HIV children, because there's so much of uncertainty.
He lost parents, he lost his community, but he found one thing from us, Jesus.
You know, our lives are changed when we are with those children, you know, that we take life for granted, but that's not the case for these children. They live day by day.
We have a born-again Christians, teachers, born-again Christian caretakers.
My name is Vinoda. I am now 21 years old. Totally, I am taking care of 15 children in my room. So this is Java. She came to our hostel. She was very thin and also lying in the bed only. So she is also suffering from TB, tuberculosis also. So this is the tablet. This used to take for 6 months at a correct time. I think she is very good now. She's taking her food correctly. She's taking her tablet also at the correct time. I have a faith that she will take God's hand.
Eniya rakka aasuthri kudir pananga mudiyama irukumachile ipo konja paravala sandosama irukku.
She is helping children to understand who is Jesus. Vinoda is a gift from God.
I If I am a small age, my father and mother died, I have no any feeling about them. But I was studying 8th standard, so I know all thing about mother and father. So it was very difficult. Since I am having this disease, I know the feeling of that person. So I thought I will also help to others who are suffering like this. I thank God sometimes too for this disease, because if I have no like this disease, I won't come to this hostel, and also I did not know about Jesus Christ.
Children's lives are changed, not just physically, but emotionally. They always say hope is the last thing to die. It will never die, because we have a living hope. And that is Jesus Christ.
Brothers and sisters, I thank God. God added this opportunity in my life to see you all today here. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I thank God for the life of Pastor Jeff. He's not only praying and supporting our ministry, he's sending team of people to strengthen our faith, strengthen the faith of our children and the church community by sending the people. Last year, God helped through you to build a beautiful church in Bangalore city. Before last year, your people came and blessed hundreds of lepers and our HIV children by giving hope. I thank God for the sacrifices of many people from this church under the leadership of Pastor Jeff. Not only I thank, I also praise God the way they come and motivate our people to reach the unreached. This their sacrifice in coming and blessing us, then in return, our people also motivated to go to North India and unreached places to sacrifice for other people. Especially this ministry, when we started this small ministry, we never thought it would grow with big way. We have our church planting is our motive. With that, we thought in India how to send the workers, where to get the workers, how to reach the people. There's a big question in our mind. When we started the orphanage, I always believe that social work is good, but the final product would be the gospel work that must reach the people in the outreach. That is our thing. So when we say, look at this now, you are seeing a pastor who is living in the slum of Bangalore. The total house is 15 feet into 10 feet, small house. He's having two children. And there all are accepted Christ, and he built the church there, and he's enjoying his life by staying in the slum, being with the people, praying with the people, build the church. That's the result of the ministry. So in such a way, now God blessed us with 200 churches. Out of 200, 65 churches are built churches. Other churches are, we are worshiping in the houses, under the trees, or somewhere. But anyway, I see the hand of God every day. We started the work in a small way in the slum. Now, God helped us to reach 14 states of India where we speak 23 languages. Then we have 7 written languages. Whenever we prepare any materials, we have to prepare in 7 languages, 7 in 1, you know. Hindi, Kannada, Tamil, Telugu, like that. So I'm very much praying for the spiritual growth of our people. Say God used the HIV infected children or the parents as a tool to reach the people. Simply, we cannot give the evangelism or giving Christ in the northern states. Northern states, if you take northern state of India, less than 1% are Christians. But in the southern states, about 10% are Christians. So therefore, we are very much concentrating in the northern states. Especially, we have 3 Bible schools. One is in south, and one is in the middle Odisha, south in Karnataka. One is in middle Odisha, one is in north. We are producing the Bible college students every year. We are sending throughout India to reach the unreached. By the grace of God, now we have established a big training center in Varanasi. That's Varanasi is the place where the Hindu people in India believe that there is a holy place. Like Jerusalem for Christians, Varanasi is the place for Hindus in India and all over the world. Say this Varanasi is the place that the big river Ganga is going. The river is very much considered to be a holy river. When people die, many even rich people, they want to write a will that after the death, they want to be dipped into the river, then they wanted to cremate. So in that reason, you can see every day 2,000 bodies are cremated. God helped us to start one orphanage in that same spot. The really is a wonderful. My third son is a missionary. He is staying with his wife and 2 children. He is helping in the orphanage. Say that recently, I tell 2 incidents and go. Number one day, you know, this we have 16 orphanages in all over India. We have about 700 children. Out of 700 children, 450 children are infected with HIV. Children born with HIV, very much these children are neglected by the community because afraid of touching the children. But God brings these children through the children court, government. So we are happy to receive the children wherever they are because God helped us to train our own children as a staff nurses so that they are they are the caregivers in their homes. There is we are also receiving the siblings of the HIV infected children. We train them in the Bible school. We are sending as the missionary. Already 40 children were sent as missionaries in North India. Then another blessing we receive it. Every day we see the hand of God. We get the cooperation from the government because by sending the children, they know that here is the people they are taking care of. The children with love and care. Every month I see 1 death from our home. The children life expectancy is 21, 22, 23. But many children, they die at the age of 14, 15, since they are coming from a village where they never must have taken any medicines. See, last month one child died at the age of 14. But the beauty is at the dying stage, the final word would be Jesus. They love Jesus with a peaceful way, they go to heaven. Until now, 36 children died. Yes, thank you. 36 children died, but I believe that we all will see in the heaven. Yes. Say, you pray for our ministry. Yes, just, you know, we have many, many challenges. Like, you know, say one child died in Varanasi, that place. Then you will see the video clip. We're going to see the video clip. My son and myself carrying the body to cremate the child in the Varanasi Holy River nearby because many cremations are done there. So, you know, we didn't dip the body into the river before cremation. Everybody watched. There are many, many people watched, and especially some Hindu fanatics watched. The big group of people, they came and they wanted to argue with us, why you are doing like that, and what is the meaning? You should have dipped the body into the river. Then I was a little bit upset. Small movement, just I looked at God. Lord, give me answer, how to answer this question. Because many people are there and they want to stop to cremate the body into the thing, 14-year-old body, 14-year-old boy, you know. So I was a little bit shocked. Small prayer, Lord, give me the wisdom. Then God told me to show the death certificate to them. Just I showed the death certificate. Look at this death certificate. The child died with HIV and AIDS. Do you allow me to dip the body into your holy river? No, 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 you go ahead, you do your work. You pray. They allowed us to pray, singing songs. There was a, you know, function, celebration, because that's joined the heaven, the boys going to the heaven. You know, this is small, just example, you know. Say, you please pray for one thing. Until today, there's no medicine for HIV and AIDS. You know very well. People are doing, those days, for the tuberculosis, no medicine. Leprosy, no medicine. But now they found the medicine for tuberculosis and leprosy. But still, HIV, especially in AIDS, there's no medicine. Now, our prayer, our children are also praying every day morning, Lord, give you a medicine so that we'll have a longer life. We can go. Still, my brother is going as a missionary in the North India. I also want to go, Lord. So that's the prayer of the children. Now you'll see a video clip. Then I will appear for 1 minute and I'll go. Please see the video clip.
These kids with HIV have a very short life expectancy, and in the past 10 years, we have had 36 children die. The last one happened in February this year, 2017. When some of the children die, we are able to hand over their bodies to their families and they readily accept them. The sad irony is that when the child was alive, no one accepted him or her, but when they die, they are accepted. This happens with both Muslim and Hindu communities. There was an example when we received a boy. He was so skinny, and as he got nutrition from us, he gained weight and looked much healthier when he died. And seeing this, his family praised God, even though they were Hindus, and asked us to do the funeral ourselves, and we did it. Some HIV-infected children, like Gautam, came to Calvary Chapel at the age of 10. He was found as a baby at the railway station in Mumbai by someone who took care of him until he was 10. Then he came to us, and he was with us for the past 11 years. We gave him good education, and he even went to Bible college, and he went as a missionary to the state of Jharkhand, where he died. He was singing and praising God on the day of his death. Just like all the other 35 kids, who were also praising and singing about God when they breathed their last. We praise God for their lives. We now have 16 homes in different parts of India.
Yes. In Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 to 3 says, Abraham was called as a missionary, and God gave the two promises. God said, Abraham, you are blessed, and you will be a blessing. In such a way, God blessed you people with both. I'm so happy God has blessed you. You are also blessing to Indian ministry. When I thank everyone here, I also request you to, you, still we need some sponsors and some support for the pastors and the churches. So there are tables in the out. If you could help us, that would be great, great help. God bless you. Thank you so much again.
As Pastor Guna mentioned, in the foyer and the children's ministry courtyard, start by, and if there's any way you can support, buying t-shirts, what have you, but really you can see the work that God's doing. So keep them in prayer, keep the children in prayer. God bless y'all.
Amen. Let's pray for him. Would you stand? Let's pray for Pastor Guna. Father, we are sitting here in the midst of one of the most prosperous places on the face of the earth. And Lord, that's not to say there aren't difficulties in our own neighborhoods, but we ask that your Holy Spirit would fall afresh upon Pastor Guna and his team there in India. And we ask that you would provide for them in miraculous ways for all that they have need of. Lord, in abundance, God, that no child would pass from life unto eternal life without meeting you. And so, God, it's the goal of the gospel that we seek, and we pray to that end that you would do miracles in our midst. Sustain them, keep them, watch over them, protect them, and we ask all this in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor.
Well, we have a few moments, and in those few moments, we'll turn our attention to our passage of Scripture, a couple of verses, and staying out of trouble. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, we'll take verses 9 through 12. Now, the natural consequence of hearing the bad news for the believer, in other words, that we have some issues, ought to be the promise of the good news. Amen? And so Paul now gives us a little bit of a how-to in staying out of trouble, keeping our minds focused on things that matter. And so as we turn our attention here to verse 9, which we looked at last time, I will really focus in on verses 11 and 12 here in our remaining few minutes. Father, we thank you for your word, and we pray now that in power you would speak to us through it. Lord, we realize that it is able to take and do in our lives what the words of man cannot do, because these are the words of God. And so bless us as we study your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Verse 9, and this is looking back to last week as we ended there. But concerning brotherly love, I have no need that I should write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. The fruit of the Spirit, Paul wrote to the church at Galatia, is love. The evidence of that love, he goes on to say, is joy, peace, gentleness, meekness, self-control. And he would go on to say that against such things as those, there is no law. In other words, the law is fulfilled in that greatest command that you would love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. And then the result of that would be to love your neighbor as yourself. And so he focuses in here first on us being loving and then increasing in it. And he says, and indeed, you do so towards all the brethren who are in Macedonia, but we urge you, brethren, that you increase more and more. So grow in love is the first admonition. It is interesting to me what we occupy our time with. It's almost staggering the variety of things with which we in our Western culture occupy our time, our talent, treasure, and keep ourselves engaged in doing. And so he gives us a little bit of a how-to here, beginning in verse 11, three steps, a threefold prescription, if you will, on how to stay out of trouble. And that really is the problem that we have when we look at living a sanctified life. There's plenty of trouble out there. We want to stay out of it. So here's a prescription on how to do that. That you also aspire to lead a quiet life. So the focus is love. We're to be loving to God vertically and to mankind horizontally, but that we would lead a quiet life. Not easy to lead a quiet life in Los Angeles. Amen? It's a little difficult at times to find that quiet space, that place that we can say that we can meet with the Lord. And the next one, to mind your own business. Oh, my goodness. Thank you, Jesus, if we could live that one out. We ought to put that on the halls of Congress. Mind your own business, and by the way, spend your own money. And how to work with your own hands, to be industrious, prosperous, to take the advantage of the things that we've been given and to use them correctly for the Lord's glory, as we commanded you. That you may walk properly towards those who are on the outside, that you might lack nothing. And so
a very short 10 minutes we have remaining. And here's the three key points. It's a prescription. The first is to live a quiet life. You know, so very often in our attempt to live the busy life that we see people living around us, we get caught up in the very things that God says we probably shouldn't get caught up in. So the first step here is to live a quiet life. The second step is to mind your own business, to stay out of everyone else's business. Amen? Anybody ever been affected by somebody getting in your business? Oh my. Matter of fact, I think some of the deepest problems I've ever had is people trying to somehow run my life when they can't run theirs. They're not very effective at doing that, but they sure want to tell you how to run yours. To mind your own business, and then to engage in those things which are productive. You see, the application of love actually accomplishes something. Again, we draw our attention to the doctrine that we believe, the life that we live, the scriptures that we know, should produce something in us that actually causes people to believe that what we think and what we know, we actually believe to be true because we do it. And so our doctrine becomes the things that we dutifully engage in. And so Paul says first here, lead a quiet life. God wants us to live that way. A quiet life is not just a life that's boring. It's a life that's free from worry. It's a life that's free from extremes. You see, very often we get caught up in the tremendous highs, which are followed also by the tremendous lows. Amen? We don't always stay up here. We end up down here. The quiet life is the more stable life. It's the midline. It's not way up here and way down here. It's the middle road. It's that place that we can honestly say we're moderate in all things. Temperate is the word that Paul would use as he writes to the young pastor Timothy. You see, we're easily bogged down. We're easily beat up. We sometimes get overwhelmed because we try and live like the rest of the world lives. And as believers, we're supposed to have a more stable existence while we're here. Sometimes we're too busy. Anybody get too busy at times? Oh, I do. There are times when it's like, yeah, I can do that, and I'll do that, and I'll do this, and I'll do that. And before I know it, all my doing ends up being mediocre because I've taken too much on myself. And so one of the things, tone it down. Turn down the volume in your life a little bit. Turn off the TV. Maybe talk to your spouse as opposed to talking at the television set. You know, there are some things that we can glean from this passage. A quiet life is a life that's free from controversy. And very often having too much time on our hands plays into this, because then we get busy doing the wrong things instead of the right things. The second step in this is that we should mind our own business. Man, as I think on the things that I generally end up dealing with as a pastor, almost without exception, somewhere in the mix is a busybody. Someone who has looked at a situation, given likely some bad counsel to someone, they've spoken to somebody about something that they do not have the full story on. They're so busy telling other people how to run their life that they haven't been able to run their own, but somehow they're an expert in everyone else's life. And all of a sudden, the things that they say weigh us down. Look, here's the secret. We all have enough of our own stuff. Amen? If we focus in on our own stuff, we got plenty to do. And I think if we would just do that, instead of trying to get engaged in everyone else's stuff, as Scripture says, we'd have a whole lot less problem, and we wouldn't be the source of the problem. Proverbs 26 reminds us, where there's no wood, the fire goes out. You know, when you stop feeding gossip, you know what happens? It dies. Where there is no talebearer, Scripture says strife ceases. As charcoal is to burning coals, as wood is to fire, so a contentious man is to strife that is kindled. You see, the words of a talebearer are kind of like those tasty morsels. They go down inside, and oh, by the way, they rot there. Stay out of other people's stuff. Pray for them. Pray more, talk less. That's my counsel to you. Amen? Pray for them. When you see that brother or that sister doing the wrong thing, going the wrong way, if you have not heard from the Lord, you need to speak into that person's life, then you take them to the throne of grace, because therein you and they shall receive mercy. Amen? Don't be a talebearer. It's a step. Mind your own business. And here's why. Notice verse 12, that you might walk properly towards those on the outside. The world's watching us. When the church is guilty of bagging on everyone, when we get involved in everybody's stuff and we're wandering around, it's like, nyah, 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 nyah. I have these foam things. I throw stuff at the TV. It's like, don't say that. All it's going to do is stir stuff up. Maybe one of the biggest things that we face in our country right now as a whole is you got lots of this and none of this. You know, you might want to engage your brain before you open your mouth, kind of thing. The world's watching. So when you name the name of Christ and you're busy doing things the world's way, then the Lord, in essence, is getting the blame for us not acting according to what His Word says. So He says, walk properly towards people who are on the outside. And then thirdly, a final thing, when you think on this, you know, as the world is watching us, we should be the very best. We should be the best employees. We should be faithful. We should be on time. We should be respectful. We should do our jobs better than anybody else does them. Because people are watching to see what a Christian actually does. You see, before they will believe in the Jesus that we love, they need to see that what the Jesus does in us is real. Amen? They need to see it work. So when you tell somebody that you're a Christian and then you don't show up for work on time, or the work that you do is poor, you're constantly grumbling and groaning and complaining, when you do that, then people look at it, well, if that's what your Jesus does, I'm not sure I want any of that. They're watching. And so being a Christian's not a license to relieve us from hard work. And so He says, work hard with your hands. And if you do that, and we take these three things and just simply enact them in our world, we live a quiet life, we stay out of other people's business, and we work hard, the world's going to take note of that. That actually will cause people to believe that there's a benefit to being a Christian. You see, but when Christians spend all their time prognosticating about when the return of the Lord's going to be, for instance, you know, it drives me nuts. I mean, all this blood moons and the Shemitah and the numerology and the feast days, and, you know, you'll sell a lot of books doing that. Why don't you try working hard and staying out of other people's business? Living a quiet life. You know, you're not going to sell many, many books by just living a quiet life. Unless you're a poet, then maybe that will work. But the bottom line is, we want the Lord to know that He can count on us. And look, nobody cares whether we come up with another date for the return of the Lord. People have been doing that for 2,000 years. We're going to get to the rapture of the church here really shortly. And so the people in Thessalonica were all worried about when the Lord's going to return. Look, Jesus is coming, amen? And He's coming soon, amen? But soon is relative to His time, not mine. So He may be back today. That's my hope, the blessed hope of the glorious appearing of my great God and King. So on one hand, even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Today would be great. But the problem is, if I sell all of my stuff, move to Montana, build a bunker, buy a bunch of guns and bombs and ammunition, and I dig a hole and I live in it, I ain't telling nobody about Jesus. Okay? Because that means my Jesus needs to move to Montana and get in a little compound somewhere. Look, my Jesus lives in Lomita. And my Jesus is in Gardena, and he's across the street in Carson, and he's in Compton, and he's over in Watts, and he's here with us. So let's stay here, live quiet lives, stay out of other people's stuff, and work hard, and tell people about Jesus. Amen? We made it. We're 2 minutes over. We do that. Don't freak out. We need to get ready for the rapture for sure. But the bottom line is, no one knows the day or the hour when the Son of Man comes. Only the Father in heaven knows that. He's foreordained the day and the time. He knows when that is. We can trust him with it. But the one thing that we can do to make sure that we have done all that we can do is to share the gospel. Amen? The Great Commission is to not go share the date or the time that the Lord's going to return. The gospel is to go make disciples of all nations. That's the Great Commission. And so that's enough for us to do. Amen? Would you stand with me and we'll pray. Father, thank you, thank you, thank you for your goodness and your love to us. And we pray, God, that as we live our lives, would they be peaceful and quiet? Would they reflect your character and nature? God, would we stay out of other people's business and focus on our own things? There's surely enough if we do that. And God, would we work hard? Would our lives be an example of industriousness that's used for your glory and for your kingdom? And Lord, while we wait, we do pray, even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Lord, if it could be today, that would be super for us. But Lord, there are people that need the gospel. And so we pray, if you choose to tarry, that we would be busy to that end, sharing your love with a lost world. We bless your name. We thank you for all that's happening all over the world through this church. We pray that you'd cause that sphere of influence to increase and for multitudes to be saved. We ask all this in the wonderful name of Jesus. And God's people all said, amen. Amen.